Welcome to lecture number 19 of the course Introduction to Data Science. Today's topic is responsible data science. There will be two lectures devoted to this topic. This lecture we will focus on giving an overview of responsible data science and at the same time zoom deep into, let's say, algorithms to ensure fairness. In the second lecture on responsible data science, we will focus on confidentiality, so things like privacy. So here we find an outline of what we will talk about today. We will talk about what is responsible data science. We will show that there are trade-offs between different topics. So for example, to ensure fairness, we may want to violate confidentiality. To ensure, let's say, lots of confidentiality, we may lose accuracy. I will give plenty of examples to explain this. Then we zoom into two concrete techniques that you should know. One on discrimination-aware data mining, how we model and measure it. And we will look at a concrete technique based on decision trees, where we are changing the labels of the leaf nodes in the decision tree to improve fairness. What I mean exactly by this will become clear later. So first, with a high-level overview of responsible data science. So here we see a diagram that we have used throughout this lecture series. Most of our attention has been going into the analysis part, the part in the middle, where we looked at many different data science techniques. On the infrastructure part, we talked about things like pre-processing, etc. In two lectures, we will talk about big data technologies. So we will talk about how to distribute data science techniques over multiple computers, and we will look at topics like streaming data science. We already talked a bit about effect when we were talking about different visualization techniques. When we talk about visual analytics, the role of the human is of course extremely important, to see certain patterns that an algorithm doesn't pick up. But today we look at more negative effects of data science, where it is creating unfairness or where it is like violating things like privacy. So without further ado, let's walk into the different topics. So here you see a high-level overview. As mentioned, we look at fairness, accuracy, confidentiality, and transparency. Fairness is about how to avoid unfair conclusions, even if they are true. Accuracy focuses on how to answer questions with a guaranteed level of accuracy. Confidentiality focuses on the question how to answer questions without revealing secrets, so things like privacy. Finally, transparency focuses on the question how to clarify answers such that they become indisputable. Transparency has two different aspects. One aspect is to ensure that the entire data science pipeline is such that what the people want to come out also comes out, that there was not some error along the way. So the data science pipeline and what has been done with the data before producing the results should be transparent. Also, if results are being produced, it's vital that end users can really understand these questions properly. If not, they may draw completely wrong conclusions. So let's look at each of the four questions that I raised. So the first one is how to avoid unfair conclusions even if they are true. And this is the central topic of this lecture. I will now just give a very quick introduction and then we come back with two very concrete techniques trying to ensure fairness when we are doing data analysis. So our lives today are driven by automated decisions or semi-automated decisions where algorithms play a role. So for example, data science techniques are used to decide whether you will get a loan or you will get a mortgage. It is used to decide will you get an insurance, health insurance, car insurance. It is used to decide whether you are hired by a company or not, whether you are admitted to a university or not, and whether you will get certain medical treatment or not. So this slide is showing that data science is influencing our lives in dramatic ways. So very important decisions for individuals are based on data and data analysis. Sometimes completely automatic. Sometimes the data science technique gives diagnostics and the human then needs to interpret this and make a decision. So these decisions are everywhere and they are changing our lives completely. In this lecture, also the next lecture, I'm forced to give all kinds of examples that need to be clear. And when we talk about things like discrimination, we immediately think about things like gender, race, age, etc. Yeah, so all the things that you can imagine. I use these examples to be clear. It is not my intention to confirm any stereotypes, as this slide shows. I do not support any forms of discrimination or prejudice. Also, I simplify matters. So for example, when I talk about gender, I just talk about male and female. But as you know, by German law, there is also, let's say, the notion of a third gender. I do not bring this into examples to not overcomplicate things. Okay, so what are now the examples of unfair decisions based on data science? And I'm showing some examples, but you can find many more. So for example, it turns out that facial recognition software works very well on white people, but doesn't work so good on black people. Probably because these techniques were developed by white engineers. Another example would be the decision whether people need to stay in jail or not. They would need to stay in jail where they have a high likelihood to re-offend. Also, models were used there. And this is a very well-known example, where the likelihood that black people would re-offend was much higher than for other, persons in prison. So this is showing how data is reflecting prejudices and how algorithms can automatically make decisions that are wrong. Sometimes it's also simply a signal that is in the data based on historic things, and sometimes these algorithms are amplifying inequalities of the past. Another example related to the notion of redlining, which I will explain on the next slide, is that Amazon refused to deliver to certain areas, and the people living in these areas were particularly neighborhoods with many minorities in them. People were offended that Amazon did not deliver to these areas, but Amazon's response was that they were not using race or whether people were from a certain minority or not. It was based on, neutral parameters. But of course, these neutral parameters were highly correlating with, for example, where people come from and what color they are. So this is becoming a big topic, and also many large organizations see that they need to be very careful with these things to not lose customers. So this is becoming important, and that is why I devote, a lecture to exactly this problem. So what is the problem of redlining? It actually exists already for a very long time. Here you see a map of 1936, and this map is indicating, which people in what areas can get a mortgage and where not. So what you see is here, the parts in blue are the parts that are desirable. The parts in red are labeled hazardous here. And this is indicating these are areas where the bank would not give a loan because the risk of people not paying back the loan was too high. This is an example that shows that in your data set you can remove race, gender, age, etc., etc. But if people are living in particular areas, then just by labeling these areas in a certain way, we are indirectly, let's say, treating, let's say, different subgroups in a different way. Sometimes with good reasons, sometimes also not. There is this very nice website that you can see here where you can look at these old maps and you can see, let's say, how neighborhoods were labeled. In these maps, you can see the label A until D, where A, which is green, is the best, D is red, is hazardous. And here you have an example of one of these maps. So the color coding is slightly different than before, but the idea is the same. The areas in red are the areas where you should not get a mortgage. And there are also strange comments, like the comment that you see here at the bottom. So I show this example to illustrate that even if we leave out things like race, age, gender, etc., it can correlate with other variables, and if we use these variables to select, then we still have certain effects that we may not want. So algorithms are, of course, based on data, and it is not often not the case that algorithms are wrong, but they are just, let's say, amplifying what is in the data already there before. And so this is showing that algorithms should somehow be designed from scratch to be aware of values and not discriminate. Just to illustrate this, I can take the let's say simple example of a Google search query. And you all know that if in Google you type a few words, then Google is trying to predict what you're going to type next. And this is, of course, based on what people typically look for. But if you look at these things, then you realize that, let's say, such autocompletes do not always indicate a desirable and fair behavior. Now, if you're using such an autocomplete for, let's say, deciding on a mortgage, deciding on whether people get admitted to a master program, whether people will get a kidney or not, then you realize that that is problematic. So, this is the issue. And in one of my earlier lectures, I talked about Simpson's paradox. And this example is kind of closely related to what was then explained in the context of Simpson's paradox. And it basically shows that it is not so easy to decide what is fair and what is not. Consider this artificial example. There are two study programs, medicine and computer science. In medicine, there are much more females that want to study that program than there are males. And with computer science, it's exactly the opposite. So more males want to study it rather than females. Now, the acceptance rate in medicine is 20%, and the acceptance rate in computer science is 40%. And apparently, it doesn't make a difference whether you're male or female what the acceptance rate is. And here you have the acceptance numbers. But if you add up these numbers, you realize that only, although the number of females and males is the same, 1,000, you can see that in the end, more males get accepted for 360 compared to the 420 of females. So here, within each study program, we do not discriminate, but overall, the effect is such that, let's say, more males get admitted to this particular university than females. So you can decide whether that is fair or not. Let's now change the scenery a bit. We still have, let's say, 1,000 females and 1,000 males, but now the acceptance rates are different for females and males. So now more males get accepted into medicine and more males get accepted into computer science. So the distribution overall is even worse than it was before, because only 190 females get accepted and 410 males got accepted. But if we look at this now it seems that we can conclude that there is discrimination, illegal discrimination here, because even within the same program we make a difference. So if we go back to our original numbers and we remove computer science, so there are certain viewpoints where you could say, okay, this is a fair distribution, because apparently males choose computer science, and in computer science the acceptance rates are higher, so it's only logical that we have this effect in the end. But that is based on the assumptions that females and males can choose themselves what study program they choose. But now I replace study program by, for example, the location where you live. Can you choose where you live or not? That may be related to income. Then there is the question that there may be such a distribution based on age. You could choose to study computer science, you cannot choose to be above or below 50. That's a fact of life. You can also think about things like race, nationality, etc., etc. So now the question is, before we said, okay, yeah, because the acceptance rates are the same within all the study programs, we thought it was fair, but if we now look at the situation, you may conclude differently. So this is showing that fairness is not so easy to define, that there may be intentional discrimination, but often it is unintentional, because these are phenomena that are somehow hidden in the data or the particular way that we look at the data. Yeah, so samples are often, let's say, not representative. And we do not want to amplify inequalities in the past into, let's say, future decisions. What we will also see, and specifically with the technique that we will present at the end of this lecture, where we are relabeling the decision tree, it may be very counterintuitive that we deliberately modify the decision tree to make the predictions worse, but to ensure fairness. Yeah, so there is a trade-off, and this trade-off will be revisited several times in this lecture. If we have sensitive attributes, because a very simplistic idea could be, okay, let's just remove all the attributes that we consider to be sensitive, like, for example, we remove gender and nationality. But if we are using a data set that has other variables that somehow strongly correlate with the sensitive attributes, it may be that the outcome is exactly the same. So we are removing sensitive attributes, and in the end, we are still discriminating in the way that we were discriminating before. So sometimes we want to enforce fairness. And enforcing fairness automatically means that our predictions become worse. So, for example, if we ensure fairness and we are using all the attributes, we may come up with the best prediction to decide whether somebody is going to have a credit problem or not. If we introduce fairness, our predictions will become less good. That is intentional, because we want to have a trade-off between accuracy and fairness. It is not so easy to define fairness. I think the examples that I showed before are illustrating this. This is strongly related to Simpson's paradox. some of the examples that I gave back then is, for example, one can compare two hospitals, an academic hospital and a regional hospital. It could very well be that more people die, the likelihood of dying when you enter an academic hospital, that likelihood is higher than when you enter a regional hospital, although an academic hospital is better. Or if you're treated by an experienced doctor, your likelihood to die may be much higher than when you're treated by an inexperienced doctor. Not because the doctor is making errors or the academic hospital is making errors, no, because academic hospitals and experienced doctors are treating more difficult patients that have simply a higher likelihood to die. So you can see this phenomenon, let's say, everywhere. So if you're looking at fairness, you should, let's say, very carefully think about these things that you've also seen in the context of Simpson's paradox. So we will revisit the topic of fairness in a lot of detail. The second topic in, let's say, responsible data science is accuracy. And that is, how do we ensure that the data science algorithms are producing, let's say, reasonable results? One of the big problems is that if you use data science techniques, for example, you create a very sophisticated neural network, it always gives an answer. And like, if you are a human and you're not sure, you perhaps don't want to give an answer at some point in time anymore. But if you have a classification algorithm, it is classifying every instance. And there are lots of dangers. So you may overfit, you may be overfitting the data, making predictions that work very well on the training data, but will perform very bad on, let's say, unseen data. But there are also things like the curse of dimensionality. So if your number of variables is huge, you can basically fit any curve on that data. So ideally you have fewer variables and you have many more instances. There could also be spurious correlations, and the basic idea is if you use data science and you ask lots and lots and lots of questions, the data science algorithm will always give an answer. And another problem is that if you ask it many questions, it will by accident, based on the data, make certain conclusions that are just there by accident. Well, this is the area where we talk about things like spurious correlations. So for example, you can look at lots of, let's say, data sets. And here I have a data set where there's a strong correlation between iPhone sales and people dying by falling from the stairs, although probably there is no relationship between them. The example with the jelly beans, I gave that in one of the earlier lectures. This is an example where we start by testing one hypothesis. Do jelly beans cause acne? And the answer is probably not. And because we are not satisfied with this answer, we start testing it for every possible color of jelly beans. And suppose that we have hundreds and hundreds of possible colors. Eventually, we will find the color where, based on our data, we can conclude that jelly beans cause acne, jelly beans of that particular color. But this is, of course, nonsense, because if we test many hypotheses, just by accident, some hypotheses will be correct. So here you see another example. If you look at the bottom, you see this URL where you can find lots of graphs showing these spurious correlations. And one, let's say, name that you should know is Bonferroni, of the Bonferroni correction. And he stated that if you test enough hypotheses, then by accident, one will be true. So if you're testing a large number of hypotheses, you should somehow correct for this. There are techniques to do this in a certain way, but that is beyond the topic of what we talk about today. So just to illustrate, let's say, the curse of dimensionality and testing many hypotheses and potentially making very bad choices, I use this kind of artificial funny example where we try to find terrorists in the Netherlands. So in the Netherlands there are 18 million people. Let's assume that there are 1800 hotels. Let's assume that Dutch people on average stay one night in a hotel every 100 days, but this is, let's say, randomly distributed. Yeah, so on average a person is staying in a hotel once every 100 days. And if you compare these numbers, then you know that per hotel on average there are 100 guests per night. Let's use these fictive numbers, and we are now interested in finding terrorists. And we try to find them based on suspicious behavior, and we define the following behavior to be suspicious. It is very suspicious if two different persons, are staying in the same hotel on two different days. Yeah, so then we think that this is a very, let's say, suspicious event. And we look at the 1,000-day period, yeah, so let's say 3 years, we are looking at the 1,000-day period, and we are trying to catch the terrorists by looking at which people have this suspicious behavior. So let's do some calculations. So remember, we had 1,800 hotels. People were staying, let's say, on average, one night per 100 days in a hotel. And we have 18 million people. So we start by looking at what is the probability that two persons, I just pick randomly two persons, what is the problem that on a particular day they are both staying in a hotel, not a specific one. That is 1 divided by 100 times 1 divided by 100. Easy. Right? So this is two persons visit a hotel on a given day D. Now, we look at the probability that these two persons that visit the same hotel on a particular day, that they actually stay in the same hotel. Well, there were 1,800 hotels, so then we get this probability. So that's already a very small probability. Now we compute the probability that two persons visit the same hotel in two different days. Right, so now I pick 2 days. What is the likelihood that two persons stay in the same hotel? So if we now look at this this expression here, we see that the likelihood that this is going to happen is incredibly small. So we may conclude, whoa, we should catch all the people that have this type of behavior, because the likelihood that this is happening is very small. But now we are going to look at the number of candidate events. So this was the probability that two given persons visit the same hotel on two given days. Now we look at the combinations of persons and days. So we had 2,000 days. So this is the number of combinations of 2 days without considering the order. That we can take. We can also look at the number of combinations of two persons. That's this expression. If we look at this expression, the number of candidate events, so combinations of two persons and 2 days in a 1,000-day period in a population of 18 million, is this number. Now we need to multiply this times this, and then we find the expected number of suspicious events is equal to 250,000. So this example is showing you, okay, things may have a very small likelihood to happen, and you may be very surprised then that it happens, but if there are many candidate events, or if we are testing many hypotheses, then automatically these things will be true. if we test it often enough. So this is the problem of accuracy. So things may seem to be very rare or very special, but they are actually not. And we should avoid making conclusions in such situations. The third, let's say, area of attention within responsible data science is confidentiality. How to answer questions without revealing secrets. And these are the things that you see in the news every day. In general, you can say that if you're not paying, you are the product. So if you are using things like Twitter, things like Facebook, things like Instagram, or whatever service that you're using that is for free, or if you're searching on Google, if you are not paying for the service that you're getting, you are the product. And this is simply, let's say, a fact of life, and many people don't realize this. So if you are the product, then these organizations want to have your data. They want to know about your behavior, and they would like to influence your behavior. And we see scandals related to this every day. And something that is considered to be acceptable on one day may be unacceptable on another day. So we all know the, let's say, the Facebook scandal related to Cambridge Analytica. And unfortunately, these are not exceptions. These are things that we see all the way. So the big tech companies are providing services for free. And in return, they get data. They may nudge, they may influence your behavior. And that is why you don't have to pay. So you can find this in all areas. So if you look at banks, if you look at insurance companies, if you look at governments, they all have problems related to that. So they want to have the data, and the data may have all kinds of side effects. Yeah. So probably everybody of you is using Google on a daily basis and not paying any for it. So Google is using your data in a particular way. So I think this is clear. These are some older news articles, but also if you look in the newspapers over the last couple of weeks, you will find similar information. So these concerns are becoming bigger and bigger and bigger, and that is why, let's say, politics start to get involved in this discussion, and also why for the companies themselves, the social ethical concerns become more and more important. What is important to realize, because based on this presentation, we may think, okay, this is just a problem of Google, Facebook, Twitter, Spotify, etc. But of course, these concerns, these privacy concerns, also play inside, let's say, much smaller firms. Specifically because there is new legislation, GDPR, and GDPR stands for General Data Protection Regulation. This is a regulation that came into effect in 2018, and it is defining very high fines for companies found guilty of misusing data. So GDPR is very broad, and it's also a bit vague what it exactly defines, but it is talking about things like privacy, but also transparency, and that people should have the right to opt out. The basic assumption is that people should understand how their data is being used, which is of course very difficult. As I mentioned, GDPR is not something very clear. The scope is very broad. Here you can kind of see the areas touched upon by this General Data Protection Regulation. And it ranges from that people should give consent beforehand, before the data is being used, but that people, for example, also have the right to have their data removed. which is not as easy as it seems, because of course when data has been used to produce other data, that is, let's say, a non-trivial activity, and sometimes it's also not so clear what it means exactly to erase somebody's data. So confidentiality is an important topic, and in the next lecture we will zoom in on this problem, and we will talk about things like how to anonymize data, how to encrypt data, and also again how to extend data science techniques to get the utility, to get the results that one would like to have, without violating, let's say, topics like privacy. The last in the sequence of four areas of data science which require attention is transparency. So transparency has two elements related to it. One side is if we are using a complex data science pipeline, it is very important that people that look at the results at the end understand what has happened in this data pipeline, because certain filtering, certain pre-processing may influence the result. And so people need to be able to understand the whole data science pipeline. At the same time, things should be presented in such a way that individuals are not tempted to make the wrong conclusions. Think again about Simpson's paradox. I can present exactly the same data in two different ways, and people are likely to make completely different decisions based on it. So, to illustrate the problem, consider that, let's say, a physical judge is replaced by a neural network. And of course, this is still the future, but there are already legal systems that are supported by data science techniques. But if decisions are made somehow automatically, it could be that we enter some input and the neural network, based trained on many, let's say, criminals from the past, is making the decision whether somebody should go to jail or not. So input is your profile, output is you go to jail or you don't go to jail. Imagine that you have such a neural network. For many of us, it would be unacceptable that a neural network would decide something like this. Not just because it's an algorithm rather than a person, but also because when we look at a neural network, we cannot explain why a certain decision is being taken. So this is about, let's say, a judge being replaced by an algorithm. But we can also think about deciding whether you are admitted to a master program, whether you will get insurance, whether you will get a kidney, whether you will get, the COVID vaccine. You can think of your own favorite examples. In many situations, it's not acceptable to have an algorithm make a decision that it cannot explain. Because just by looking at the weights in this neural network, that's not going to help. So there are different ways of coming to these results and explaining these results. It could be a complete black box, which I say, okay, this is the answer, you are rejected without any explanation. If we look at the neural network, it's basically doing that. So you enter data, and the neural network has been trained on historic data, and then it decides to reject. And it cannot really explain why it made that decision. So what we see today is that when people talk about explainable AI, they are using a neural network to make certain decisions. And from this neural network, they are trying to generate rules that are somehow explaining why in certain situations certain decisions are being taken. If we look at decision trees, of course, these are much more transparent, because given your descriptive variables, you can just walk through the decision tree and see, let's say, why the decision tree decided to label your case as reject. And you can also generate automatically an explanation for that. So these are different levels of transparency. And next to this, being able to explain the result, what we have seen is that data science results are often based on not just one step, but a long sequence of steps where we are pre-processing the data. So we are extracting the data, we are cleaning the data, we are filtering the data, we are doing parameter tuning. We choose a particular model where we can represent certain things but not other things, etc., etc., etc. So from this complex network of different steps, we come to some conclusion. And what we see there is, let's say, the phenomenon that we can often observe in the real world. If one person says something to another person, and that person says something to another person, etc., etc. I'm sure as a child you have played this, let's say, in the classroom. Then what you see is that what this person tells at the beginning and what comes out at the end is completely different. So this is what is happening if we have a complicated data science pipeline. It could be that the result that comes out at the end is not so related to the data that went in at the beginning. So that's why we should be very careful about these things. And that is why transparency is an important topic in the field of responsible data science. So in summary, if we talk about responsible data science, we talk about, let's say, four areas of attention indicated by, let's say, the acronym FACT. F stands for fairness, A stands for accuracy, C stands for confidentiality, T stands for transparency. In this lecture, we will focus on fairness. In the next lecture, we will focus on confidentiality. If we look at FACT, of course, it is related to the FAIR principles, but at the same time, it's very different because FACT is looking at the effect that data science has on people, not how to facilitate data science in an easy way. Okay. So what is obvious, this part of the lecture is relatively brief because I think it's completely obvious based on the examples that I give, is that there are trade-offs between, let's say, the four areas that I just indicated. So for example, there is a trade-off between confidentiality and accuracy. So if we are able to use all the data, we have little confidentiality, because we're using everything, but probably the utility, so the accuracy of the results and what we can do with it, is maximal. On the other hand, if we want to have, let's say, a lot of confidentiality, we are removing all the information that can be potentially harmful. It may be that the utility of the data is very low. So we are often looking at the trade-off in these things. We find a similar trade-off if we, for example, look at the trade-off between fairness and accuracy. So if we want to be super fair, we don't want to discriminate, and because we don't want to discriminate, we may have a very low accuracy, similar to ensuring lots of confidentiality. At the same time, if we are trying to develop algorithms that make the best possible prediction, it may be that it is super unfair. This trade-off will become very clear in this lecture, where, for example, we will look at relabeling the leaves in a decision tree to trade accuracy for fairness. So we are looking for something where we have a reasonable fairness and a reasonable accuracy. how we measure these things exactly will become clear, let's say, in a few minutes. Okay, after this long introduction that was covering the entire field of responsible data science, we now focus on discrimination-aware data mining. So this is a particular sub-branch within the bigger field of data mining and machine learning. There are many, let's say, conferences and workshops devoted to this, and this field kind of came into existence with, let's say, this first paper. So in the remainder of the lecture, I will focus on this paper that I will explain in a minute, and this paper that we see here, which is working on, let's say, relabeling leaves in decision trees to improve fairness. And with these two examples, you get a pretty good idea of what this area is about. So these are two concrete ideas and approaches that you should know and should be able to apply. So the problem with the term discrimination is that there is the meaning that like unjust treatment of different categories of people, especially based on grounds of race, age, and gender. So that is one interpretation. The other interpretation is recognition and understanding of the difference between one thing and another. And of course, if we think about the classifier, we are trying to do this. So we are trying to discriminate, for example, between the people that are going to pay their mortgage back and the people that will not pay their mortgage back. Or we are trying to discriminate between the students that in the end will graduate and the students that will drop out. Or we want to discriminate between the patients that are likely to survive and the patients that are not likely to survive. So we would like to discriminate with respect to a certain target variable, but we do not want to discriminate based on sensitive attributes like race, age, gender, and you can think of many more things. So the problem is that, as I've alluded to already before, is that fairness is not so easy to measure, it's not so easy to define. Because if we look at the input data, we can, based on the input data, we can create the best possible classifier that exists. But if the data already has a certain bias, so it could be a selection bias, it could be that it is describing something that was the case in the past and that does not hold anymore. It could be that the learning technique is simply picking up on these biases and is amplifying them in new outcomes. What is also possible is, for example, that in our original data, certain minorities were not represented well, so the learning technique will not pick up on these things, and people will never be selected. So this is not so easy to define, and we will concretely look into this topic in a minute. As mentioned before, there is of course a strong relationship between confidentiality and fairness. So we are now going to define discrimination in two different settings, and we are going to look at how we can prevent this from taking place. So first we look at measuring discrimination based on this paper, Discrimination-Aware Data Mining, that I mentioned before. So to do this, I need to repeat some things that we have seen before, and I'm also going to generalize the classification approaches and the item set-based approaches that we have seen before. So we looked at many, let's say, classification techniques, like, for example, decision trees, logistic regression, and we have seen many of other techniques. So we looked at classification, and we looked at frequent item sets and association rules. And I'm going to unify these two concepts using, let's say, the notation that you see on this slide. So at first it may look very different, but if you think about it, it is combining, let's say, both worlds. So we have a set of features called attributes in this paper, A1 until AN. Then we have items of the form A is equal to V. So we have an attribute name A is assigned a certain value V. We call this an A item. Yeah, so it's assigning a value to attribute or feature A. So I is, let's say, the set of all items. So we look at all possible combinations of taking an attribute name and assigning it a particular value. Yeah, so here we see A1 can have value V11, V12, etc., etc. Then 2 to the power I is the power set of I. These are all the sets of item sets, right? So we are going to look at subsets of this. And there we are particularly interested in subsets which assign a value to every attribute. But of course, we only assign a value to each attribute once. Yeah, so we assign a value to attribute 1, a value to attribute 2, until a value to attribute n. Of course, we cannot assign 2 values to the same attribute. Yeah, that's the note that you see here at the bottom. So if we talk about a transaction or also other concepts, we assume that these are not, let's say, conflicting. And this is because we are generalizing the concepts of item sets and classification. So a transaction database is a set of transactions, and again, a transaction assigns a value to every attribute. Now sets, subsets of I, they're called item sets, just as before, but now they have this particular form where there is attribute name and a value. So this is an example of an item set. It assigns value male to attribute gender and value old to attribute age. If we write X, Y in this paper, it means the conjunction of 2 item sets. So we just take them together. We have a transaction, and when we were talking about items, we would simply say subset. Here, in using the terms in this paper, we say T verifies X, where T is a transaction in our database. X is an item set, something looking like this, if X is a subset of T. Yeah, so for example, if T is equal to this, yeah, so suppose that we have 3 variables, then for a particular transaction, we need to assign a value to each of these 3 attributes. And then we have X. X is an item set. It just has 2 elements. And this is then verified, yeah, because this is X is a subset of T. I think this is easy to understand. If this is difficult for you, please go back to the lecture on item sets and association rules, and then you can see that this is a very simple generalization. So we defined support before, and this is looking at the fraction of transactions in our database that is verifying X. Yeah, so we look at all the transactions where X is included in them, divided by all the transactions. So this leads to a number between 0 and 1. As I said, we are trying to generalize classification and the things that we talked about in the context of association rules. So we can now, using this notation that I introduced before, we can write x implies y. And this could be a rule of this form. Yeah, so, and this rule would say male old people imply live in Aachen and work at RWTH. So this is an association rule as before, where we can talk about support and confidence. A special rule is a classification rule, where on the X side we just see one item, and that item is always an item for, so let's say, some classifier C. Yeah, so Y, that is basically says that given X, we predict that the class is V. Yeah. Simply a very specific interpretation of this more general notation that we had before. So independent of whether we have an association rule or a classification rule, our machinery remains the same. So based on this, we can talk about a support of such a rule. Note that on the previous slide, we had support here. If, just like in association rules, if we talk about the support of a rule, that is the support that both are present. Yeah, so we look at all the transactions where X and Y are included, and then the fraction of that. We can also define confidence. Yeah, so we now know what support is. So the confidence of X implies Y is the support of X and Y divided by the support of X. So you can think of this as the conditional probability: if X holds, does then also Y hold? Here is an example. So this is all a bit verbose, but it should be obvious and clear when you have carefully paid attention in the earlier lectures on association rules. The confidence of the rule X implies Y, given this, can be defined as that. So we look at the number of records, the number of transactions that have these four feature values, divided by all the records that have these two feature values. And of course, this leads to a number between 0 and 1. If we have a classification rule, then we know that on the other side of the arrow, we have this single class label, but the mechanism is exactly the same. As I said, so far nothing new, but I just want you to get used to the notation. Now we jump into the topic of fairness. We are going to use the notion of extended lift to reason about fairness. So we have a certain base rule, B implies C, and we are now thinking about, okay, should we be allowed to use this rule if B then also C? And this could be C could be, for example, a classification. A person gets a mortgage, a person gets a kidney, or whatever. So can we apply this rule? And whether we can or cannot apply this rule will be based on extended lift. An extended lift is the change in confidence of this rule if we add, let's say, sensitive attributes. Think of when I write A, think of, okay, the person is female, the person is a foreigner, the person is above 80, whatever, right? So we are looking at a rule like this. And if this extended lift is very high, then we conclude that we cannot apply this rule, because the strength of this rule would be much stronger than for other groups. So that's the basic idea, and to explain this more clearly, I need to introduce some terms they're not always, let's say, very clear and very logical, but I'm just following the terms and the approach that is described in the paper. So we have 2 to the power I. These were all the possible item sets. And ID is a subset of that, and these are called the potentially discriminating item sets. So these are combinations of items that we consider to be sensitive, a potential source of discrimination. We assume that this set ID is downward closed. That means that if we take a potential discriminating item set and we take another potentially discriminating item set and we combine both, then by definition, this set is also potentially discriminating. So an example would be that if we take one item set, one potentially discriminating item set, gender is male, country is the Netherlands, and another one, age is above 50, then the combination is also potentially discriminating. What may be perhaps a bit confusing and a bit difficult is that we are talking about item sets and not a single A item. And the reasoning behind this is that sometimes just looking at what one attribute is not considered to be discriminating, but looking at the combination of attributes is considered to be discriminating. So for example, and this is of course a fake artificial example, it could be that gender is male is not considered to be potentially discriminating. Job is hairdresser is also not considered to be potentially discriminating, but the combination of both is considered to be discriminating. A similar example, it could be that if gender is female by itself is not discriminating, but the combination of gender is female and condition is pregnant, that combination is considered to be potentially discriminating. So these were the potentially discriminating item sets. The potentially non-discriminating item sets are all other ones. And so it's the set that we started with minus all the ones that we defined to be potentially discriminating. And so in the example of so ID containing female and pregnant, it could be that just looking at female is not potentially non-discriminating. What we will often do is that we will split such potentially non-discriminating item sets into 2 parts. And so if we have X, which is a potentially non-discriminating item set, we will often splitting it into a part A and a part B, where A is potentially discriminating, B is potentially non-discriminating, and we do this in such a way that A is maximal. And so we are looking for the largest A, so the largest potentially discriminating subset, and then we write X as A comma B. And what I already explained, B is part of the base rule that we are interested in. So whenever we write X is equal to A comma B, we assume that there is such a split. So we split it into the part that is potentially discriminating and the part that is potentially non-discriminating. So we are now interested in rules of the form B implies C. And I already mentioned the notion of E-lift. So we are now interested in such a rule where the confidence of the rule varies strongly between different groups that we consider to be sensitive and groups that we would like to protect. So we look at direct discrimination and indirect discrimination. In direct discrimination, we look at, so we are interested in the rule, the base rule B implies C. But we extend this rule B implies C with a potentially discriminating item set A, And so A is an element of ID. And now we are interested in looking what is now the effect of adding A on the confidence of the rule B implies C. So A is in our data set and we can directly check it. The indirect setting, when we are looking at indirect discrimination, we are looking at the following setting. So now we have a rule of the form D, B implies C. We are still interested in the rule B implies C. But now we are not looking at a potentially discriminating item set A. We are looking at an item set D, which is in principle potentially non-discriminating. So D could be, for example, the area in which people live, which we did not define to be potentially discriminating. So we are looking at this rule, but we are looking at these that are somehow strongly correlating with some other item sets which we consider to be potentially discriminating. So in other words, in our data we have a potentially non-discriminating item set D that in itself is harmless, but if D is strongly correlating with some potentially discriminating item set A, then still this rule can be discriminating. So this is rules of this form are we use them to look for direct discrimination. What kind of effect does the presence of A have on this rule? If we look at rules of this form, we are looking at indirect discrimination because D does not refer to things like gender, race, nationality, etc., etc. But it may correlate with something else. So think about the redlining example that I showed at the beginning of this lecture. Okay, if you understand this, the rest is super easy. So we are interested in rules of the form, base rules of the form B implies C. And we look at what is the effect of adding A. And that effect is represented by the extended lift. And that is the change in confidence by adding A. So we look at the confidence of A and B implies C divided by the confidence of the rule B implies C. And if this is above some value alpha, we consider it to be a case of direct discrimination. So this threshold is called alpha, and that's why we talk about alpha discriminatory. Yeah. So let's look at an example to make this clear. So we have a sensitive attribute, gender is male, and we are looking at a base rule, work is RWTH, implies rating is poor. Assume that the confidence of this rule, so people working at RWTH have a poor rating. Suppose that the confidence would be 0.2. And we compare this confidence with the confidence that we get by adding A. So adding gender is male. Suppose that that is 0.8. And we have an alpha equal to 3. So we have set our discrimination threshold to alpha is equal to 3. Then we compute the extended lift, as I've explained before. So the confidence of this rule B implies C is 4 times as large if we are also zooming in on let's say instances where gender is male. That is 4 is bigger than our alpha. So we say this rule is a case of alpha discrimination. So we say it's better to not use this rule because there is this, let's say, significant increase in confidence of applying this rule if we include gender. Now I change examples. So the things that are in light blue are the things that I've changed. So what we are now doing is we are looking at people of an age above 50. The previous example, we were looking at gender. Now I show you the new values, and now the extended lift is equal to 2. So the confidence of the rule B implies C is 2 times as large when we also consider, let's say, this age attribute. And because our threshold was set to 3, we consider this rule to be not alpha discriminatory. So given that threshold, it is okay to use this rule. So this is direct discrimination, where we are looking what is now the effect of a certain rule if we add, let's say, sensitive attributes that we consider to be potentially discriminating. So let's try to visualize this, what is really going on in this setting. So suppose that we look at the rule, if people work less than 10 hours, they don't get promoted. Suppose that I compute the confidence of that rule, B implies C, and the confidence is 0.1. So that confidence in principle is low. Now we can interpret this rule, and why is the confidence of this rule is 0.1 is because if we look at the items that have B, then 10% of this green square also includes the purple square. Now we look at adding a sensitive item set, so potentially discriminating item set A. So A is gender is female and condition is pregnant. Suppose now that all of these instances, all of these persons that have A are all inside the overlap between B and C. If this is the case, we compute the confidence of this rule. It's the same as before. That of course doesn't change, but adding A leads to a confidence of 1, which is the highest confidence possible, because if we look at the items that have both A and B, these are exactly these items and they are all in C, so we get the confidence equal to 1. This should be obvious. So if we have set the threshold to 3, we would say, okay, in this example it's clearly discriminating. Suppose now that the females that are the persons that are female and pregnant are all within the square where people work less than 10 hours and are also overlapping with the part where let's say C and B overlap. If we have something like this, we see that the E lift is equal to 2, because the confidence of this is that, yes, this is now, let's say, first it was one, the purple part was 1/10 of the green part. Now the purple part is, let's say, 1/5 of the part where A and B coincide. If we now play a bit with, because now we are assuming that all the instances that are female and pregnant work less than 10 hours. If I extend it in this way, it does not make any difference, right? Because for this rule, we are looking at the overlap between A and B. So we still have this factor 2 that we had before. I can also change it in this way. And this is effectively the same as looking at the original C situation. In this situation, we would say that the E lift is equal to 1. It could also be that, let's say, A is outside of the B area, and then we get an E-lift equal to zero. Because the overlap is zero, we get a confidence equal to zero. In the example so far, we were looking at rules of B implies C, and you can think of C as a classification rule. Of course, I can also take the negation of C. And in the paper, these two are combined. So this is, think of positive and negative discrimination, and they could be taken into a single metric. I left that out here. It's also not important for understanding the main concepts. Here we are looking of let's say, one-sided rules, where we are just looking at the E-lift being above a certain value. If you are interested in C and not C, we can simply apply this ID two times. Yeah, so that was direct discrimination. Now we are going to look at the case of indirect discrimination. So for direct discrimination, we are using directly a potentially discriminating item set. And we test what is the effect for this group. We also talked about things like redlining, where we are not, so there is a variable that is actually not in our data set, we are not using it at all, but still it is strongly correlating with sensitive attributes. Like the location where you live correlates strongly with, I don't know, what nationality you have or something like that. So to explain this, this is the setting that, so the base rule is city is New York City implies class is bad. So this is our base rule. And when we were looking at direct discrimination, we looked at what is now the effect, the extended lift of adding race is black. Right? And if we do that, we can see the effect. And based on that, we decide whether there is direct discrimination or not. Now we look of rules of the form D, B implies C. So again, we have the same base rule. So city is New York is equal to B, class is bad is the same as C. And now we look what is the effect of adding neighborhood. And neighborhood is not a potentially discriminating item. But still we test it, because this may strongly correlate with potentially discriminating items. So this is showing the overall picture. So this was the original setting, where we have rules of the form A, B implies C. So we have a data set, and the data set contains information about gender, race, age, etc., etc. And we see what is the extended lift by adding such attributes on the rule that we would like to use, B implies C. That was direct. Now we look at indirect discrimination. So we have a data set where the attribute A, so for example, race, gender, stuff like that, is not appearing in our data set. But we have background knowledge, and the background knowledge is saying something about the relationship between D and A. And if D and A are strongly correlating in the context of B, if that is the case, then although based on the data set itself, we cannot find discrimination, effectively, that is discrimination, because people live, for example, in a particular area. So that's the basic idea of, let's say, this indirect discrimination. So again, now we're with numbers. So we have a base rule. New York City implies class is bad, has a confidence of 0.25. If we add race to it, the confidence increases to 0.75. So our extended lift is equal to 3. that was direct discrimination. And so based on this number, we may conclude that the rule is discriminating. Now we look at a rule that is of the form B, D implies C, where D is referring to the neighborhood, and that is not necessarily a sensitive attribute. But D is strongly correlating with A, specifically in the context of New York. So we see that B, D implies A has a confidence of 0.8. So in our data, we did not have any race, but as the example shows, is that people living in New York in this neighborhood, 80% of the people that live there are black. So then if we are using this rule, it is the same as using the direct discriminatory rule that we had in the beginning. So using such, let's say, call them correlations, we can compute bounds for the extended lift. So we combine a potentially non-discriminating rule with background knowledge, where we infer a rule where we can give, let's say, a lower bound on the confidence that that is there. Right? And that leads to the situation that I just sketched. So again, let's formalize this a bit. So this is what we have seen before. Again, there is a base rule, B implies C. We are interested in the extended lift. What is the effect of adding A? If that lift is above a certain threshold alpha, we say that the rule is discriminating and we do not want to use the rule B implies C. If we look at indirect discrimination, we have a data set where we do not have this A item set, but we have a D item set, which is not necessarily composed of sensitive attributes, but we have this background knowledge. So we have the background knowledge that the combination of A and B implies D, and the combination of D and B implies A. So this is our background knowledge. And if these are high numbers, we are effectively saying that in the context of B, A and D are strongly correlating if these values are high. So based on this, we want to evaluate the original rule, A, B implies C. And here, the paper shows some, let's say, derivation that you do not need to know. It's actually an interesting problem to derive that by hand. You don't need to do that. But the outcome of this is that if we are looking at a rule D, B implies C, where again D is composed of, let's say, attributes that are not necessarily sensitive, but we see that the rule A, B implies D and D, B implies A has a high confidence. So just take alpha and beta as, let's say, high values, because that's the setting that we are interested in, then giving values for alpha and beta that refer to background knowledge, we know that this rule, A, B implies C, is alpha discriminatory if this expression is larger than A. So what is interesting about this is that we are only using beta 1 and beta 2, and we are applying this rule, and what you should note is that A is not appearing here. So we use this background knowledge, this abstract background knowledge, which may be based on assumptions, and we are computing, let's say, a minimal extended lift, although we do not have direct access to A. I think this is pretty clear, although, let's say, the derivation of how you get from this to this is outside the scope of this lecture. if this expression leads to a value bigger than alpha, we don't want to use this. Just to make this clear, and I think this should make the point, we are looking at the rule of the form D, B implies C. And now we suppose that A and D strongly correlate in the context of B. That means that the confidence, if I have A and B, that the confidence is then 1. That all the items that have A and B also have D, and all the items that have D and B also have A. This means that A and D are strongly correlating. If we are in that setting, now I have my beta 1 and my beta 2 values, I can just fill them out. And if I fill out, so here we have beta 1, beta 2, 1, 1, then we can fill out these values, and if we do so, then we get this expression that's bigger or equal to alpha. And this matches our intuition that if D is like a proxy for A, because it's strongly correlating, then using D is the same as using A. And this matches what I was saying before. So if we try to visualize this, we now have A, but we do not really know A, but we have kind of a proxy for A that is indicated by the D area. And if the D area is let's say, strongly correlating with A, then we can compute, let's say, an estimated extended lift value for A, by using the relationship between A and D. So far, we have been looking on how to measure the level of discrimination, for example, using the notion of extended lift when we add the sensitive attribute. Now we are going to look at a technique that is not just measuring the level of discrimination, but is also changing the way that we classify things to trade accuracy for increased fairness. So as we have seen before, is that there is already a bias, or there is already discrimination in our data. And if we learn a model, then of course the model will also reflect and make the same discriminating decisions that were already in the data. Just to illustrate this a bit, assume that we take this data set where we use experience, degree, and job to build a decision tree with a certain outcome, for example, whether people will get a raise or whether people will be fired or whatever. We may learn this decision tree. Note that in this decision tree, we are not using gender in any way. We could extend this data set with a sensitive attribute, gender, that was not used to build the decision tree. And then it could be that there is a strong correlation between the sensitive attribute and the class that we have. So if we just would consider this attribute sex, then this would be the classifier that we would have. And this may be undesirable because it could be that this decision tree that we have here is predicting the corresponding class in a good manner, but at the same time is discriminating. And we can see that if we ignore all the other attributes and just build a classifier based on the gender column. So this may be due to a historical bias or whatever reason. Now the question is, this decision tree is effectively labeling females with a negative category and males with a positive class. So do we think this is acceptable or not? So we would like to make these decision trees fair, and there are three approaches to do this. The first approach is that we modify the data. That is pre-processing. So we remove all discriminatory attributes, as we have seen, that is not enough. if our data set is then unbalanced, like in the data set that we have just seen, we may, for example, remove or duplicate instances to reduce the bias. So in pre-processing, we are basically adapting the data to ensure that certain biases are being removed. Of course, there still can still be indirect discrimination, so just removing attributes is not enough, as we have seen before. Then there are techniques that try to improve fairness while processing. So we are building a decision tree, for example, and while building the decision tree, we are not making certain splits because they would lead to unfairness. That's a possibility, and there is a possibility to simply apply the technique and use post-processing at the end. So we basically learn a decision tree that optimizes for finding the right classifier, and then we modify the classifier in such a way that accuracy is reduced just a little and fairness is improved a lot. And all of these three techniques are, of course, balancing between fairness and accuracy. So we are using a different way of measuring fairness compared to the previous paper. Here you see the expression. And let me walk through it. So we have a classifier. And the classifier is basically mapping attribute values onto two classes, the plus class and the negative class. Unfortunately, because we are using different papers, the notations vary all the time, although the concepts are very, very similar. So B is a binary, this classifier tries to guess an attribute B, and B is the sensitive attribute. So for example, gender, and gender may be 0 and 1. And throughout the slides, we are trying to protect the instances that have a B value equal to 1. So think of 0 as male, 1 as female, or 0 German, 1 Dutch. So we have this sensitive attribute B, we have a classifier, and now we are going to measure the level of discrimination as follows. We compare the probability of getting a positive label for an instance with B is 0, so this is the group that we are not protecting, minus the probability of getting a positive label for an instance with B is equal to 1. So if the difference between these two values is 0, then we know that the probability of getting a positive label for the group B is 1 and the group B is 0 is exactly the same. If this value is high, let's say half, then the probability of getting a positive label for the group that we do not want to protect is significantly higher than for the group that we are trying to protect. So let's just look at the notation. So this is looking at, so these are all the instances in our data set that have a B attribute equal to 0. And we look in this class, we look at the fraction of instances that have a positive label. So this is the fraction of instances in the group B is 0 that have a positive label. This is exactly the same, but now we look at the group B is equal to 1. So this is the group that we would like to protect. So that's the basic idea. And when we look at the class label, we can look at the data itself. So for example, here we have an expression which is again taking the difference, and the idea is exactly the same as on the previous slide. But we can look at the data. So x.class is the the class that was actually there in the data, and we can look at the result of the classifier. And of course, we cannot change the data is what it is, but we can change the classifier. So we will use these two notations. So we measure the level of discrimination based on the data only, or we measure the level of discrimination based on the classifier and the data. And we are going to modify the classifier in such a way that accuracy remains acceptable, but fairness is improved. Okay, let's take a look at an example. So here we have a data set. So we have the B is 0 group and the B is 1 group, males and females. Here we have the other attributes, and this is the class that we find. So we don't see a classifier here, but we could have an additional column with what the decision tree would say, which tries to match as much the real class as possible. So if we look at this example, then we look at the fraction of B values that have a plus, that's 4 out of 5. And then we look at the B as 1 group, and then we see just 2 out of 5. So then the level of discrimination is 0.4. 4 divided by 5 minus 2 divided by 5. So this is the level of discrimination, and ideally it would be 0. But just like with e-lift, we can set a certain threshold here. So there is of course a threshold that we should consider, and we are looking at a trade-off between accuracy and fairness. So we want fairness and accuracy to be as high as possible. Discrimination is the inverse of fairness. So we would like this value to be as low as possible, and we would like the accuracy to be as high as possible. We are looking for Pareto optimal points on this curve. And the point is Pareto optimal. If there is no other classifier that is scoring better in both dimensions. So we say a classifier is optimal with respect to discrimination and accuracy. If for every other classifier that we can think of, discrimination is bigger or accuracy is lower. Right? And if that holds for all other classifiers, then this classifier C is Pareto optimal. Okay, so we now know how to measure discrimination in this particular approach. And now we are going to change the decision tree. And we can do this on the fly while building the decision tree, or we can modify the decision tree at the end. So please remember the lecture on decision tree learning, where the idea is that we start with all the instances and that we try to split based on descriptive features in such a way that the leaf nodes are as homogeneous as possible with respect to the target feature. And the better we are able to separate things, the better our information gain is. So this was based on the level of entropy. So this was, let's say, the formulas that we have seen before. They are very similar to the formulas that you see in this paper, although notation is slightly different. So we are looking at information gain. In other words, we are looking how much can we reduce the entropy, and the entropy is lowest when all the instances have exactly the same label. And at every step, we try to pick an attribute, a feature that is maximizing the information gain. So that's what we have seen before, and I assume that you still remember that vividly. We now have this set where we have a classifier. And for example, so we are splitting based on all kinds of attributes, non-sensitive attributes. And now we look at the end result, and we have these five leaves. And we see that, for example, this leaf is quite homogeneous. The others, it's clear that they are, let's say, more homogeneous than what we started off with. That's guaranteed by the algorithm. But some of them are not conclusive. And then we take the majority. So for example, in this leaf node, there are four instances. Two are labeled fired, one is labeled promotion, one is labeled stay. We pick the majority, and that is fired. So this is not using any sensitive attribute. This is what the optimal classifier has returned. Now we can label things based on, let's say, some sensitive attribute. And what you see in this example is that, for example, all the elements in this class are female. All the elements in this class are female. All the elements, all the elements are female in this class. So the end effect of this classifier is that all the females get promotion and can stay, and all the males are fired. Okay? And this was an attribute that we did not use, but this is what the outcome of the algorithm returns. It could also have been that the result was like this, that this was more mixed. Yeah? So now we see a kind of equal distribution over the different classes. Yeah? So for example, in this class, getting promotion, we see that in total, three males get promotion and three females get promotion. How can we address the fact that we would like to avoid this situation, where there is a very uneven distribution over the different sensitive classes? Well, we can address this by looking at the decision tree, and while building the decision tree, we are aiming for creating, let's say, splits that make the leaves nodes as homogeneous as possible. And in terms of our sensitive attribute, we would like to have the opposite. So we would like to have the things to be as inhomogeneous as possible. So we have two measures. We have the classical information gain, IGC, which is just as we have seen it in the earlier lecture on decision trees. And we are doing exactly the same, looking at the sensitive attribute, for example, gender or age or nationality. And the goal is that here we would like to maximize the information gain. Here we would like to minimize the information gain, because maximizing the information gain with respect to the sensitive attribute would lead to discrimination. So we can combine both measures, and we can combine both measures when we are building the tree. So in the paper, there are three approaches described. The first two are very obvious. The third one requires some explanation. So the first one would say, we try to maximize IGC minus IGS. And again, the goal is to maximize this and to minimize this. Another variant is that we do IGC divided by IGS. And it's trying to do the same thing here. It is trying to maximize the classical information gain, and it is trying to minimize the gain in sensitivity. In other words, it's trying to minimize the discrimination. What is counterintuitive is that the paper also describes an approach to maximize IGC plus IGS. At first, that sounds or looks very, very bad. But you have to realize that if we do this, then we get leaf nodes that are probably homogeneous in, let's say, the target class, but also homogeneous in the sensitive class. And if we maximize both and we get nodes that are homogeneous both in terms of the classifier that we are trying to learn and homogeneous in terms of the sensitive attribute, for example in gender, then because we have these homogeneous classes, if we want to modify the tree, we have easy access points where we can modify the tree. And so normally, so we don't want to do tree without applying post-processing. But the first two, you can just apply the existing decision tree algorithms using this different splitting criteria. This is the way that it works. It can be done in processing. So we can just take all the existing approaches for decision tree learning and just look at the combination of IGC and IGS. And I think this is pretty obvious. The technique that I would like to discuss in more detail is modifying the tree after learning it. So as I said, there are three different approaches. There's an approach where we pre-process the data, so to remove any biases from our input. There is the approach where we are not just pre-processing the data, but we are doing this while learning the tree. And there is the approach where we are post-processing the tree, where we are changing the leaves as we have them. And this is the technique that I'm going to explain in detail. And then we are also done with this lecture. So the idea is to improve fairness, and this can only be done by lowering accuracy. So we need to sacrifice a bit of accuracy to hopefully gain a lot in fairness. And the idea is that we have the decision tree as we have learned them. So instead of a decision tree, it could also be a different technique. But we have some classifier, and we are basically modifying the outcome for certain instances. And so here the majority was green, can stay, but we just modify it by giving this a label fired. And here the majority was blue, fired, and we relabel it to promotion. And relabeling this will lead to lower accuracy, and it will, if we do it correctly, lead to improved fairness. So this is the basic idea, and these are pictures taken from the book. So you should think of this as a decision tree, as we have seen before. These words refer to the different attributes that are used to split, but their names are not relevant. But we, based on some classifier, we have these as our leaves. And here we are drawing, let's say, instances where we have the following convention, that, the instances with the circle belong to the class that we are trying to protect. The instances without the circle around it belong to the other class that we are not trying to protect. And we have an instance can have a plus label, class label, or a minus class label. And then we have these white and gray areas. And the white areas correspond to where the majority is positive. So the decision tree would give the label plus. So for example, we are looking here at L2. And L2 has label plus because of the five instances in it, five are positive. The gray areas are the areas where the resulting label of the root node is negative. So for example, if we look at L5, That is, we follow the split by A and then by A2, and then we have this class, and that is labeled with a minus because it contains two instances that are both labeled minuses, one of the group that we're trying to protect and one of the other group. So I hope the notation is a bit clear. Here it is again explained. So again, we have two class labels, plus and minus. The leaf nodes of our tree are relate to certain areas that we see here. And we label these areas with the majority. So for example, in L1, the majority is minus. So that is why it is grayed out. In L4, the majority is plus, and that's why this is white. And again, the encircled instances belong to the minority group that we are trying to protect, with B is equal to 1. So this is, the text here is basically explaining what I've been saying before. So we now want to relabel the tree, and we can basically relabel the tree by changing the colors of these areas. So for example, I can take the area L1, and it now has a negative class associated to it, as we can see here, and we can change it into a positive class. So I think this is pretty obvious. I'm just showing an example in a compact way, and we can show the confusion matrix as we have seen before. And so we have the class and we have the predicted class. And so this is the class in reality, the predicted class. But in addition to a normal confusion matrix, we also add, let's say, the sensitive attribute, which can have value 1 or 0. Remember, 1 is the minority class that we are trying to protect. So if I look, for example, at U1 are the instances that have a negative class label, that are predicted to be negative, and that belong to the group that we are trying to protect. If I take, for example, a look at X2 are instances that had a positive label, that are also predicted to be positive, and that belong to the class B is equal to 0. So the class that we are not trying to protect. So if we now, and perhaps I should explain that N1 is equal to U1 plus W1, N2 is equal to U2 plus W2, V1 plus X1 is P1, V2 plus X2 is P2, and B are all the instances in this row, and B bar are all the instances in this row. So now we can look at our accuracy. So what are the labels, the instances which are correctly classified? For example, the ones that are labeled minus are predicted to be minus, so that's U1 plus W1 is equal to N1, and we have this one plus V1 plus X2 is equal to P2. So N1 plus P2 is, let's say, the number or the fraction of instances that have that are labeled correctly. Now we can look at discrimination, and we are applying the formula that we had before. So we are looking first at the other class, the class that we are not trying to protect, and we are looking at the fraction of the instances in this row B that have a positive label. So that is equal to W2 plus X2, because that's where the predictor says it's positive. And we take W2 plus X2 and divide it by B bar. And then we see the fraction of instances in the group B is equal to 0 that have a positive result. and we subtract this by U2 plus V2 divided by B. And U2 plus V2 divided by B is the fraction of instances in the group B is equal to 1 that has a positive outcome. So this is showing, let's say, in fictive numbers, accuracy and discrimination using the formulas that we have seen before. So this is highlighting again what I just said. So N1 plus P2 is, let's say, the number or the fraction of instances correctly classified. And this is referring to, let's say, the discrimination. So again, if we look at the red part, this is the fraction of males getting a positive prediction. If B is 0, corresponds to males. If B is 1, corresponds to females, then this is the fraction of females getting a positive prediction. That should now be completely clear, and this is just applying this formula that we have introduced before. So if we are relabeling the tree, we cannot change the class that is given, that's in our data. But what we can change is we can change the predictor. If we are changing the label of a leaf node in a decision tree, we are basically modifying things. By modifying the labels, we can move instances from plus to minus and vice versa. So this gives us a handle to change these numbers. And we change these numbers in such a way that accuracy gets reduced and discrimination gets lower, in other words, improves. So let's take a look at, let's say, the data set that we had before. So again, this diagram is showing 20 instances, and we are showing, let's say, the various fractions in the form of a confusion matrix. So let's first take a look. So this 5 divided by 20, these are all the instances in the group that we are trying to protect that had a negative label and were predicted to be negative. So these are all the circles that have a minus class label and that are in a gray area. These are all the instances that have a positive class, are predicted to be positive, and belong to the group BS1. So these are all the elements here that have a circle, that are plus, and that are in a white area that is, let's say, classified positively. So these are, let's say, these two ones that we see there, but it should be now completely obvious how I'm labeling these things. So for example, this 1 divided by 20, this was an instance of the group that we try to protect that has a positive class label, but that was predicted to be negative because it's in a gray area. We can also do that for the group that we are not trying to protect. So B is equal to 0, and the arrows, let's say, show where the values come from. So now, based on these numbers that we have here, we can compute accuracy and discrimination. So accuracy is N1 plus P2. So N1 P2 is 8 divided by 20 plus 8 divided by 20 is 0.8. So the accuracy is 0.8. Now we look at discrimination. Discrimination was given by this formula. I can look up that in this diagram, and the arrows are indicating where the values come from. So these are for example, 1 divided by 20 is W 2, and W2 is this cell. And so these are the people in the group that we are not trying to predict, that had a class that was negative and were labeled positively. So this is something that is bad for discrimination. So I'm basically getting these numbers by filling out the formulas that I've explained before. That should be pretty clear. And now the idea is that we would like to modify, because we now understand how these formulas work, we now would like to modify the decision tree in such a way that the accuracy goes down a bit and the discrimination is improved a lot. And that's the basic idea. So for example, we could take a look at this leaf node. And this leaf node is interesting because there are two instances of the group that we are trying to protect that are now labeled negative. So if we change the class label of this leaf node from negative into positive, we are seeing an increase of the group that we are trying to protect of 2, right? And we would only see an increase of 1 for the group that we are not trying to protect. So let's just see what the effect is of changing this. Well, the effects are given here. Yeah, so we are basically using the numbers that we see here. This is showing the classification for this particular leaf node. And if P is bigger than N, so the number of positive instances within a leaf is bigger than the number of negative instances, then that leaf node is labeled with a plus. However, if we want to modify this decision, we change the label of the leaf from plus to minus. And the effect on accuracy and discrimination is indicated here. So for example, if P was bigger than N, then and we swap, then P was correct and N was incorrect. If we now swap this, then N becomes correct and P becomes incorrect. So the impact on accuracy is N minus P. Because P is bigger than N, we see that the effect on accuracy is negative. And that is supposed to be like that. Then we look at discrimination. So U plus V was positive and now becomes negative, increasing discrimination. W plus X was positive and now becomes negative, decreasing discrimination. And note that by changing the label from plus to negative, we only are increasing the number of negatively labeled instances by a classifier. And now we can see what the effect on discrimination is. So if this term is bigger than this term, then discrimination will increase. If this term is bigger than this term, then discrimination will become less. Then we can look at the setting where P is smaller than N. Then the label of the leaf is minus, right? Because the majority was negative. And we can artificially swap the label from plus from minus to plus. And this has a negative effect on accuracy, and it may have a positive or negative effect on discrimination. So this is the effect of relabeling. So we see that it always has a negative effect on accuracy, relabeling, but it may have a positive effect on discrimination. And we are trying to find the leaf nodes where the sacrifice in terms of accuracy is minimal and the gain in fairness is maximal. So this is the example that we had before. So the majority is minus. So that's why this is grayed out. But we can change the the label of this leaf node to plus. That means that there are two instances of the protected group where we change the classification from negative to positive. Because in this class P is smaller than N, these are the formulas that describe the effect. Here I just fill out the numbers that we had seen before. So we are applying this rule. We see P minus N is 1 minus 2, is having this negative effect on accuracy. And it has also a negative effect on discrimination, which is good, because a negative value here is improving fairness. So for every relabeling, we can look at the effect on accuracy and the effect on discrimination. And we can, of course, look at all the possible relabelings. This is an NP-complete problem, where we can also use all kinds of heuristics to look for certain classes, certain leaves that we would like to relabel. So a summary, there are three ways of improving the fairness of a decision tree algorithm. The first one is to massage the input data. That means that, for example, we are removing any biases from our input data, for example, by removing instances or duplicating existing instances, which are positive examples. We can apply fairness guidance in the algorithm while it is learning the decision tree. And so we can extend information gain to try to maximize the information gain in terms of the classifier that we are trying to learn, and to minimize the information gain in terms of the discrimination that we are applying. And we can post-process the decision tree by selectively changing some labels. So I hope that this gives a good introduction to the field of, let's say, responsible data science. It has been a bit of a long lecture because I covered, let's say, all of the four aspects of responsible data science: fairness, accuracy, confidentiality, and transparency. The rest of the lecture focused on fairness, where you learned two ways of quantifying fairness. And you learned one way of, let's say, modifying, intervening with the decision tree before, during, or after learning a classifier. In the next lecture, we continue on the topic of responsible data science, and we focus on confidentiality. This is some literature, but of course the two papers that I highlighted are the two ones that are most important. What remains? So we just had our first lecture in responsible data science. The next lecture will focus on confidentiality. Then there will be one lecture related to big data. But as I mentioned before, there are two instructions related to big data. We cannot see that here. And there will be one closing lecture. See you next time.